We demand to see Brother Johnson.
Who the hell are you?
I'm the minister for Muslim Temple number 7.
Never heard of you.
Where is he?
Nobody here by that name.
Wait a second. What is your name, fella?
Don't worry about what my name is. Two witnesses saw Brother Johnson brought in here beat up. Nobody saw him brought out.
You didn't hear the sergeant? Outside.
I suggest you look outside that window.
Jimmy, come here, sir.
Yes, we intend to see Brother Johnson.
Who the hell are they supposed to be?
They're brothers of Brother Johnson.
Eddie, let me take a look at that blotter.
We got a Muslim. Relief must have put it down.
Must have.
Yeah, but you can't see him. Because you ain't his lawyer.
No lawyer, no see.
Well, until I'm satisfied that Brother Johnson is receiving proper medical care, nobody will move.
My name is Monty Ross, and I have had the pleasure of working in the film and television business for the last 35 years. You know, I was energetic, you know, able to run around and, you know, make sure everything was all operational and happening for a guy by the name of Spike Lee. And we worked well together. We were able to do almost, I guess about 10 films we worked on together and that sort of thing. But it all started out way back in the day at, for me, it was, I ended up graduating from Clark College. I started out at Morehouse, that's where I met Spike, and, you know, had a wonderful time learning all about filmmaking and acting and theater, and here we are. Well, we didn't know we were gonna end up working, you know, having our own company and working on 10 films and doing a film a year. That was kind of, well, we talked about it, you know, we talked about, you know, what could happen. And I think in school for us, what was important, Spike was at Morehouse, but Morehouse didn't have a school of communications and mass communications department, but Clark did. And so he ended up taking his classes over there. I think for us, it was just an exciting time to be involved in film and television.
Is there a problem here?
Big problems.
I heard that.
You come to our town year after year and take over. We was born here, gonna be here, and gonna die here, and can't find jobs because of you.
Yeah, right. Can we go? Okay, can we just go?
We may not have your education, but we ain't dirt neither.
Yeah, and ain't nobody said all of that, all right?
You Mission Park's always talking down to us.
Look, brother, I'm real sorry that you feel that way, okay? I'm really sorry about that.
Are you black?
Take a look in the mirror, man. Look, man, you got a legitimate beef, all right? But it ain't with us, okay?
Are you black?
Hey, look, man, don't ever question the fact whether I'm black. In fact, I was gonna ask your country, Bama ass, why you got them drip-drip chemicals in your head.
Right, goddammit.
And then come out in public with a shower cap on your head.
Theater, for me, became like that one thing that I could do well in school. You know, I was having a hard time in school just trying to figure out what I wanted to do and that sort of thing. And I wasn't fitting into, you know, I wasn't fitting into like the fraternity life. I wasn't fitting in, you know, I was doing okay in my coursework. But when I walked across the street, went to Clark College and got into theater, the next thing I know, I'm blossoming. And largely due because of people like Sam Jackson, his wife, LaTanya Richardson, another guy by the name of Al Cooper. From there, it was Bill Nunn, who just recently passed last year, but Bill was there, you know. So, and even Kenny Leon, who's now like Kenny's like one of the best directors, you know, in the business now, he was there. And just so happened on spring break, his girlfriend at the time was Angela Bassett. And she would come up and just, you know, hang out and talk shop. And it was different then, because our director, Joan Lewis, right? Joan's thing was, you guys should just learn to bond and hang out with each other. And so, as opposed to putting each other down and you know, what's the latest beef with Chris Brown and Soldier Boy now, and you have all those kinds of things. And I guess that's good for business in one sense. But back then, we just hung out. I mean, theater was our passion. We loved theater, and we shared ideas with each other, you know, we kept each other, you know, really, I guess we kept each other, you know, abreast of what was going on in the business. And we always felt, it was weird, the feeling, like if one person made it, then we felt like, well, okay, I can make it, that sort of thing. And Sam and his wife, Latanya, they were older than me, you know. But at the same time, they were my mentors, you know. And so, like I said, when Sam went to New York and was a part of the Negro Ensemble Company, Latanya was a part of the Negro Ensemble Company, he said, okay, I can do it too, you know. And so I would say that, you know, yeah, you can be by yourself in this business and you can be very successful. But at the same time, it's good to have a small group of people. And so I was very fortunate to have that small group of people that I could learn from, you know. It was Joe's Best Style Barbershop. We cut hair, Spike's thesis film. I was the lead actor in that movie and won a Student Academy Award. And then a year later, we were still wondering what we were going to do, and eventually got down to She's Gotta Have It.
I want you to know the only reason I'm consenting to this is because I wish to clear my name. Not that I care what people think, but enough is enough. And if in the end it helps some other people out, well, then that's fine too. I consider myself normal, whatever that means. Some people call me a freak. I hate that word. I don't believe in it. Better yet, I don't believe in labels. But what are you gonna do? In my experiences, I found two types of men. The decent ones.
I know it sounds corny, but if I didn't follow you, I might not ever
see you. You're right, that does sound corny. And the dogs. I've never seen anybody like to look at themselves more than you do. Don't you ever get tired?
Never happened, baby.
I was production supervisor on that. And, you know, we got the film made in 12 days. And afterwards, it helped launch our careers. And the next thing you know, the movie's being released by Island Pictures, you know, which was a small company at the time. It was just, Island Records was more popular than Island Pictures, but the film generated $7 million. And next thing you know, Spike had written his next screenplay, which became School Days, and after School Days was Do the Right Thing. And little did we know that we would have the impact on the industry that we did. Today I feel African-American cinema television is at a renaissance in a sense. There's a lot happening, you know, and with the addition of streaming and the internet, I say there's enough for everyone, and it all depends on your flavor. But I will say that, you know, one of the things we've got to definitely concentrate on is what we actually do. There's a lot of talk about what we don't do, but what is it that we are doing? What are we doing well? You know, not only the actors who are doing well, you know, and hats off to everyone who's been nominated for an Academy Award this year, but who are some of the other people behind the scene? You know, for me, it's people like Preston Holmes, Grace Blake, and others who have been in this business, you know, a long, long time. So who are those people? And Preston and Grace Blake are two of the best producers in the business, especially someone like Grace Blake, who was a trailblazer, and I met her on School Days. But my point is that what do we do well? Let's talk about that, and let's put that at the forefront. So yeah, I mean, Box Office Mojo is great, you know, but let's have our own Box Office Mojo that can tell us, you know, here are the 10 films. You know, here are the 10 films that distributors are out there with, who are African-American subject, but it's out here in the marketplace. Let's talk about that. Let's break that down. Let's really talk about, you know, some of the producers who are doing, you know, very well. Some of the set designers, you know, Wynn Thomas worked on Hidden Figures, but Wynn Thomas also was Spike's production designer for years, you know, and he's worked on some really great films, you know, besides this, you know, some of the Spike Lee films. So I'm saying there's Ruth Carter, you know, and who worked in costumes, you know, for many years as a costume designer. There's Robbie Reed in casting, you know, there's Twinkie Bird, you know, and people don't know who Twinkie Bird is, but she's one of the best casting directors out there. So there's tons of things going on in our business, but we have a tendency to be myopic a lot of times and only concentrate on one thing.
Well, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, who do you think talked Mike Tyson, huh?
Gus D'Amato.
Gus D'Amato? Yeah, right. But when he died, I told him everything he knows.
Oh, yeah?
Uh-huh. That's right.
Yeah, right.
You wouldn't hit me with glasses, would you?
Yes, I would.
You would?
All those good Italian boxes there are? Graziano. Yeah, Marziano. Come on. LaMotta.
LaMotta?
Yeah.
Now, how's that? What about Muhammad Ali, huh?
Hate Ali.
What?
Ali was a Muslim and preached hate on the white people.
I'll kill you! I'll kill you! You ever talk about Muhammad Ali? You can't! You're a witch! You're a witch! I'll never stand for nobody to talk about the greatest Muhammad Ali! That's you, what? A heretic witch! Okay, look. Game over. No. Game over. Give me my glasses. Let me have my glasses.
Why don't you say please?
I'm not gonna say please. And that's not gonna stop me from being angry.
Get your hands up! Get your hands up!
Back away!
Get your hands up!
What?
Now!
Get back!
What?
Please
move.
Separate yourself!
To the wall! Against the wall, man! Against the wall!
Let go of me! That's my boyfriend!
Get back.
That's my lover!
Don't
what are you
back.
Doing?
I'm not a boyfriend. We're just lovers. I mean, no. We're just friends.
This must
just
be
friends.
Some kind of mistake.
Look, Andrew, just shut up. Officer, just shut up, all right? Look, officer, she doesn't know what she's talking about.
He wasn't trying to rape you!
Assault you!
No!
What? You sure?
Yes,
I didn't do anything!
Take the fucking gun from his head!
Talk to me, man! What?
This is just a big misunderstanding, that's all it is.
Slow. Turn around. Slow.
I was just making sure she got home safe. That's all I was
doing.
All right.
Look, sorry about that. No harm, no foul. It's just that we got a call that a Afro-American male was attacking a Caucasian woman.
You all right, man? Just a little excitement. What? No problem. What?
Come on.
What?
Don't
give me
you
a reason.
Try
give
it.
Me a reason,
don't
man.
You dare try
better
it.
Next time, man. Excuse me.
Are you crazy?
Have a pleasant evening. Take it easy, all right?
I have your badge number. I will bring you up on charges.
Shut up.
You can be sure
of that. Report. Will you shut up? What's the matter with you, huh? What are you doing telling them we're lovers? You're trying to get me killed.
It's none of their business what we do.
What a waste.
What the fuck am I doing here?
I feel the key thing for any emerging filmmaker, you know, in the digital age in terms of content, you know, take it serious. You know, take what you're doing very, very serious. And I say that because people feel like, well, there's something out there. People said, and in my mind, I'm going like, well, who are the they and who are the people? You know, you got to be very specific about it. You know, take it serious, only because you might be the one. You might be the one an audience is looking for. It doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be the same audience that Spike had. It doesn't necessarily mean it's the same audience that Ilse Ray has now. It's not going to be the same audience as Ava DuVernay. It's not going to be the same audience as Will Packer and you know, Kevin Hart. It may not be that. Because as we go forward, you know, if you're 18 today, you 4 years from now, you're looking for a different type of entertainment. If you're 15 today, you're looking for a different type of entertainment. You might not be impressed with Kevin Hart in 2 or 3, you know, years from now. So, as young filmmakers, take it serious because you might be the one that is selected by your audience, right, based on your content, that they want to go see more of your movies, right? And as we go forward, it's an even playing field now. A YouTube channel, a Vimeo channel, a Facebook channel, you know, Instagram channel is 30 seconds is just as palatable now as 30 minutes, is an hour and a half. You know, it's all content. It all depends on the filmmaker. So if you're not taking it serious, what you have a tendency to do is to, you know, show up to the coffee shops or show up to folks and complain, and you're always boo-hooing and all that sort of thing, as opposed to, you know, grabbing a camera, the best one that you have, and learning your skills along the way for your audience. And the more you do, then you grow. You can grow with your audience today. And that could be a subscription-based, you know, model I mean, somebody could just donate to your channel on YouTube or what have you, you know, whatever it is, you know, whatever content that you're providing, okay, take it serious so that you don't end up, you know, crying about, you know, well, nobody's paying attention to me. You might not be a Hollywood filmmaker, and that's okay. Whatever filmmaker, what type of filmmaker you are, is if you've got an audience of one, you don't ever know who that one person is. So in this market today, it's an emerging market. It's wide open. If you're not taking it serious, you know, it's going to come back to bite you.